Good morning. I'd like to welcome all viewers for Emmanuel's road trip. This morning we have been invited to participate in the worship service with the Ebenezer Mennonite congregation. Reflecting back on our service that we participated in with Cedar Valley last Sunday, Fran encouraged us to think about the challenge that was offered by the pastor. And the question was, why do I follow Jesus? Before I give a response to that, I would like to reframe the question slightly. And the question would be, who else is there to follow? Is there another God or gods that are worthy of our worship? Should I benchmark based on my own rationalizations, the meaning and origin of life? Should I choose hopelessness over hope? Should I choose fear over love? The scriptures give us many examples, or give us many reasons to follow Jesus. And I would like to point to three scriptures as examples. Colossians 2 verse 9. This is about the fullness of God. For in Christ, all of the deity lives in human form. John chapter 1, verse 3, Jesus was involved in the creation. Through him, all things were made that have been made. Nothing that has been made without him. And Matthew 28:20, his presence is everywhere, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded, and surely I am with you always to the end of the ages. So these are three examples from Scripture why we should follow Jesus. And I would encourage you, when you have a moment, look to Scripture. This is only a small sampling of reasons why we should be following the Lord. Now let's go to our Ebenezer service.
Peace be with you. Thank you that you have tuned in and want to worship together with us, our gracious, loving God. A warm welcome to Ebenezer Mennonite Church. I invite you to listen to God's word from 1 Peter chapter 3. This is God's word. Finally, all of you live in harmony with one another. Be sympathetic, love as brothers, be compassionate and humble. Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult, but with blessings. Because to this you were called, so that you may inherit a blessing. For whoever would love life and see good days must keep his tongue from evil and his lips from deceitful speech. He must turn from evil and do good. He must seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Who is going to harm you if you are eager to do good? But even if you should suffer from what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear. Do not be frightened. But in your hearts, set apart as Christ. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. It is better, if it is God's will, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. This is God's word. Gracious God, We have come to worship you. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Lord, our strength and our purpose comes from you. We receive joy and sorrow from your hand. Direct our steps today and turn us from the perishable things, that which we grasp. Cast your light upon us so that our lives may bear witness to the light of Christ. And use this service to do just that. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen.
All the gold. Chapter 6. It pleased Darius to appoint 120 satraps to rule throughout the kingdom, with three administrators over them, one of whom was Daniel. The satraps were made accountable to them so that the king might not suffer loss. Now Daniel so distinguished himself among the administrators and the satraps by his exceptional qualities that the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. At this, the administrators and satraps tried to find grounds for charges against Daniel in his conduct of government affairs, but they were unable to do so. They could find no corruption in him because he was trustworthy and neither corrupt nor negligent. Finally, these men said,
"We will never find the basis for any charges against this man Daniel unless it has something to do with the law of his God."
So the administrators and satraps went as a group to the king and said,
"O King Darius, live forever! The royal administrators, prefects, satraps, advisors, and governors have all agreed that the king should issue an edict and enforce the decree that anyone who prays to any god or man during the next 30 days, except to you, O king, shall be thrown into the lion's den. Now, O king, issue the decree and put it in writing so it cannot be altered in accordance with the laws of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be repealed."
So King Darius put the decree in writing. Now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, so he went home to his upstairs room, where the windows opened toward Jerusalem. Three times a day he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God, just as he had done before. Then these men went as a group and found Daniel praying, asking God for help. So they went to the king and spoke to him about his royal decree.
"Did you not publish a decree that during the next 30 days, anyone who prays to any god or man except you, O king, would be thrown into the lion's den?"
The king answered,
"The decree stands in accordance with the laws of the Medes and the Persians, which cannot be repealed."
Then they said to the king,
"Daniel, who is one of the exiles from Judah, pays no attention to you, O king, and or to the decree that you put in writing. He still prays three times a day."
When the king heard this, he was greatly distressed. He was determined to rescue Daniel and made every effort until sundown to save him. Then the men went as a group to the king and said to him,
"Remember, O king, that according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, no decree or edict that the king issues can be changed."
So the king gave the order, and they brought Daniel and threw him into the lion's den. The king said to Daniel,
"May your God, whom you serve continually, rescue you."
A stone was brought and placed over the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet ring, and with the rings of his nobles, so that Daniel's situation might not be changed. Then the king returned to his palace and spent the night without eating and without any entertainment being brought to him. And he could not sleep. At the first light of dawn, the king got up and hurried to the lion's den. When he came near the den, he called Daniel in an anguished voice.
"Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to rescue you from the lions?"
Daniel answered,
"O king, live forever. My God sent his angel, and he shut the mouths of the lions. They have not hurt me, because I was found innocent in his sight. Nor have I ever done anything wrong before you, O king."
The king was overjoyed and gave orders to lift Daniel out of the den. And when Daniel was lifted from the den, no wound was found on him, because he had trusted in his God. At the king's command, the men who had falsely accused Daniel were brought in and thrown into the lion's den, along with their wives and children. And before they reached the floor of the den, the lions overpowered them and crushed all their bones. Then King Darius wrote to all the nations and peoples of every language in all the earth,
"May you prosper greatly. I issue a decree that in every part of my kingdom, people must fear and reverence the God of Daniel. For he is the living God, and he endures forever. His kingdom will not be destroyed. His dominion will never end. He rescues and he saves. He performs signs and wonders in the heavens and on the earth. He has rescued Daniel from the power of the lions.
So Daniel prospered during the reign of Darius and the reign of Cyrus the Persian.
Greetings, brothers, sisters, and visitors. Daniel and the Lion's Den is one of the most well-known stories of the Bible. It has been thoroughly taught in Sunday school. It has been thoroughly preached from the pulpit. And it has been covered in many animated and live-action movies and TV shows. Why? Because it has all the elements of the very best adventure stories. It has intrigue and bravery, danger, a heart-stopping finale, and solid vindication. It actually ends well and you know what is going on. And best of all, it's true. It's not based on a true story, like movies which need the source material hyped up or even altered to make it more exciting. Daniel and the Lion's Den thoroughly stands on its own. Now, we read through the text earlier, but let's review it before we try to apply it to our lives. So it starts off with Daniel. Daniel, who loves and fears and honors God, and that he's exceptionally honest and good at his job. He gains the respect and confidence of the king, King Darius, which makes other people competing for the same attention and influence very jealous. A conflict is starting to brew. The competing officials, they can't find any dirt on Daniel. They can't even plant dirt on Daniel because nobody would believe it. We're talking top-level integrity. That's the kind of guy that Daniel is. So they decide to create a bogus law and use palace intrigue and manipulations to get it passed. They literally look for something that they know Daniel will do no matter what, and they make that illegal. And herein lies a really important point. They're not trying to hurt Daniel by preventing him from praying. They're trying to get him in trouble for continuing to pray, because they know that he absolutely will. While each of them might shift and switch with whatever way the winds blow or the tide is going, whatever it takes to survive, to prosper, Daniel, nah, he's made of different stuff. And he lives a very, very different way. And so they know, they completely know, absolutely, that Daniel will thrive in any system built on integrity, honesty, transparency, you know, all the things we hope for in a government and systems. So the only way then to get him into trouble within the system is to change the entire system so that it moves a different direction from Daniel himself. Daniel will not be moved from his course, so they propose to shift the course of everything around him just to get him into trouble. That is how much of a threat Daniel is to him, and that is how incredible and well-known and obvious Daniel's integrity is to everybody around him. So what do? Well, they manipulate the king through flattery and some outright lies into moving the entire system, everything in the system, just for 30 days out of its current normal trajectory, which Daniel really excels in. So they tell the king a bald-faced lie that all his top people want this law. It's what everybody wants, implying that Daniel's on board too. And they tell the king that the punishment, it should be death. Again, it's what they all have agreed on, they all want. Again, implying that Daniel is on board too. Verse 9 simply says, "So King Darius put the decree in writing." It's possible the king didn't fully understand what was going on. It sounds like a flattering thing, a unify the kingdom kind of thing, a way of bringing the blessings of all the gods on him. And hey, if Daniel's on board, well, he's wise, it's probably okay. Sure, let's do it. So keep in mind, though, that this law is in and of itself an incredible abuse of power. It would be effectively pausing every religion in his empire and solidifying the Persian belief that the king spoke for the gods, all the gods. In fact, don't even pray to them, pray to the king. It's bizarre, and it couldn't have been popular. But hey, you know, if you don't do what the king says, you're going to die, and it's irreversible. So Daniel does, okay, the next phase of the story, Daniel does exactly what the conspirators are expecting him to. And of course, we're expecting him to as well. That's what his integrity is like. Verse 10, "Now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the windows opened toward Jerusalem. Three times a day, he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God, just as he had done before." Now, Daniel, remember, he is a very intelligent person. He's intelligent enough to see what's going on, and he's intelligent enough to reason where the real danger here is. It is far more dangerous for him to be unfaithful to his God than to cross the king. He just thinks about this. But pause for a second. Think about that. Let that sink in. It isn't hard to see how you or I could be tempted to be people pleasers. I mean, it seems as if the people around us, the ones with the power to hire or fire us, to break our hearts, to lie about us, to make our lives genuinely miserable, we should make those people happy. But consider this. The power to obey God and stand for him comes from a settled foundation, solid set foundation that God is really in control. And when you and I believe that, then when we get to these crossroads of God's way or, you know, pleasing the people around us, we know exactly the way we're supposed to go. Daniel knows it. Daniel does the right thing. He doesn't alter his routine. You know, that's interesting too. He doesn't get bigger or louder in defiance. See, there was a danger in both directions. It would have been compromise to do less, and it would have been pride to do more. Biblical scholar John Wolvord points out, this was not the act of a person courting martyrdom, but the continuation of a faithful ministry and prayer, which had categorized Daniel's long life. So Daniel's critics come in and catch him breaking the law. Of course, there. Of course, that's what happens, right? And then they go and they tattle to the king, and the king himself is completely distressed. He's completely freaked out. He realizes that he has been tricked. He realizes he's been lied to. Clearly, Daniel was not on board with this, and he has the integrity to realize this. In fact, the verses say that he's greatly distressed with himself. Verse 14, when the king heard this, he was greatly distressed. Other versions make it more clear, with himself. He was determined to rescue Daniel and made every effort until sundown to save him. Verse 14. Now, according to ancient Eastern custom, the execution was carried out the evening of the day that the accusation was made and found valid. You're found guilty, they have to kill you by the end of the day. So, King Darius is doing everything in his power to shut this down. So, within the story right here, we see that the belief that Darius spoke for the gods, that he was infallible, that he was all-powerful, that he could not make mistakes, that idea is undone. Surely he does not speak for the gods. And when his officials come back to him to push the enforcement of the law against Daniel, the king is shown to be a slave to the system that days earlier had promised him godlike praise and worship. You know what? He's a slave too. He's a slave to his own mistakes, his own pride, or also in this case, to being manipulated. So, Daniel's arrested, and he's placed in the slow, painful death execution chamber. He's placed in the lion's den. Darius cries out what is the theme and rallying cry of the story. Verse 16, may your God, whom you serve continually, rescue you. He's going to say something very similar in a little bit, but that's so huge. Here he prays. Here he breaks his own law. He's not praying to himself. He cries out to Daniel's God. Now, we know the story. We know that God does save Daniel, that he shuts the lion's mouths. We know that the king has a horrible night, far worse than Daniel. Daniel's completely safe, surrounded by lions. Perhaps Daniel prayed from Psalm 22, 21 to 22. Save me from the lion's mouth. I will declare your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will praise you. So he sleeps like a baby. Darius, on the other hand, miserable night. Crack of dawn, gets up, runs to see if Daniel is alive. It's the next day. Technically, he can see if this, you know, the sentence is carried out, right? So he goes there and he finds out that Daniel, of course, is alive, that he's vindicated, he's in the clear. So then immediately officials, they're like, the questions come up. Were the lions tampered with? Perhaps they were fed ahead of time. Maybe the king tried to find a way around this. And right then and there, the king has a large part of his senior staff executed. They're like, we don't think the lions were hungry. Maybe they were fed. And he's like, well, let's shove you guys in there and see how hungry they are. And they had not even hit they were falling into the pit, and they didn't even hit the ground of the pit before the lions overpowered them and killed them. So it turns out, yeah, the lions were a little hungry. Mm-hmm. They and their families, they were all thrown in. According to ancient historian Aminius Marcellinus, it was completely normal in Persian time that when you wanted to execute someone for treason, you killed the entire family, so there's no one left for revenge. This is a harsh punishment. It's harsh. But it ends the opposition to Daniel and his people. The story concludes with the fourth public service announcement from the throne. Daniel's God is real. He is all-powerful. He saves. He rescues his people. So what are we seeing here? Let's get to this. Making God the center of your life means you stand when things around you change. Or perhaps we could look at it as moving down a particular path. If the world branches off and does something different, we stay on the same path. Now, the Jewish people at this time, they did not have power over their neighborhoods, over their government. They were refugees. They were exiles. They didn't have a lot of rights. They were completely at the mercy of the state. But that did not stop many of them from following their God. We don't know about all of them, but we have the example of Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah, and I'm sure many others who continued to follow their God. In fact, many of them found out for the first time whether they really believed in him or not. Not in Jerusalem, able to carry on their lives where the rites and the rituals of God were a part of the routine. But here it was hard. Here they had to make an effort. Here they stood out if they followed God. And that's why many of them actually found out how important it was to them to follow God. All the social and political values of being religious were taken away, and all that remained was pure faith. And even them being able to carry on their normal Hebrew faith at this time, it's made even more illegal by this ridiculous completely immoral law. It's a ridiculous law, not just for them, but for all the people of faith, different faiths, but especially for them. Would they die in order to keep praying to God? Did they need God more than they needed the security of knowing the soldiers weren't coming for them? And so Daniel is at the epicenter of this spiritual awakening of, is our faith, is our relationship with God real? Daniel is dedicated to God. He prays to God. He listens for his voice. For a time, this 80-year-old Jewish man could do this in peace, but then the law changed. He did not. He did not change his practices or adopt a I'll drop God now and repent later kind of attitude. He chose God. He continued to choose God. And you know what? This has happened again and again in history. It's cyclical. Whether it's burning a pinch of incense in worship to Caesar in Lyon, France, or recanting before an Anabaptist hunter tribunal in Zurich, Switzerland, or even simply nodding in silence at the latest anti-God, anti-God's design policy rolling out into our schools from the school boards or teachers, heads of state here in BC today. We all face the problem of sinning now to avoid trouble, knowing we can ask for forgiveness later. That's God's whole thing, right? He has to do that. The early church faced a massive crisis during each of these times in history. If a person denied Christ, could they ever be a part of the church again? Some argued yes, some said never, and some created extensive supervised paths of recovery, almost like AA. But then there's all the Christians who didn't have to deal with that question because they followed God even when it was hard, even when it cost them everything. We don't wonder about them and their relationship with God. We know they had a relationship with God. They were willing to die for God. If they're willing to die for God, then they were living for God. They knew him. People like Daniel throughout history, every time it gets tough, they continue following God. They were already doing it. They keep doing it. Choosing God when everything changes around us, when it's impossible to follow him, but following him anyway, that is a follower of Jesus Christ. And that's faith. Hebrews 11:6 says, without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. This is the difference between truly believing in God and simply wanting to cover your bases in case he might exist, or it's what's normal in our family. I'm a good kid. I'm a good teen. I'm a good person. This is what a good person does. When you and I choose to try to just cover our bases, we're constantly having to evaluate whether belief in God is worth this next bit of suffering or discomfort. Every test, every shift in society is a real crisis for us. Man, it's going to be so hard. I don't know if I want to put up with it this time round. You know what? I'll endure something minor for God, but if it's going to really hurt or if it's going to really cost me, then maybe I'll just sit this one out or be purposefully vague or avoid the situation. I'll try not to out and out lie if I don't have to, but I'll work very hard to avoid suffering for God, one that only probably exists. So this is the crisis of conscience that every believer must work through. Is this a real relationship with a real God that I really believe in? Or am I just actually gambling that I'm on the right religious side? And believe it or not, society is actually going to help us out with this. In our lifetimes, we are seeing the polarized shift from religion's great society to religion's rotten society, from people leaning toward Christianity to people being openly antagonistic towards it. This means that people who are unsure whether God really exists are going to, well, they're going to find out real quick that they're not willing to endure the unpopularity that is descending upon us. We're going to have to choose if it's real or not, because society is not going to make it easy for us to coast by on a sort of faith anymore. It will simply cost us too much. We will choose either God like Daniel, or we will reject God like so many before us, or ridiculously, a few of us may even try to change God to fit society. Like, it's one of the most absurd things of our time. The idea that if society moves away from God, we'll change God so we can stay with society. That's the progressive Christian movement of our time. It's a ridiculous notion, but it's very popular. Hey, you get to keep your faith and be popular. Ah, two thumbs up. But everybody, absolutely everybody, is going to have to make an active, eyes open to the consequences decision about the God of the Bible, which is difficult, but it's good. It's a good thing that we are in a time in history like Lyon's France burning a pinch of incense to Caesar, or the Anabaptist hunters in Switzerland, or what happened right here to Daniel in ancient Persia. It's a good thing. In 1 Corinthians 4:10 to 13, Paul's talking to a group of Christians who have much to lose from a worldly point of view if they choose to follow Jesus. And their reputation and their possessions keep them from embracing their faith in Christ. And they've actually become pretty critical of Paul and his biblical teaching. They're frustrated that he keeps coming along, talking about the cost of following Jesus, talking about surrendering everything to God, about laying down rights. They really, really don't like it. And Paul challenges their ideas in a mock debate. Okay? 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 10. We are fools for Christ, but you are so wise in Christ. We are weak, but you are strong. You are honored, we are dishonored. To this very hour, we go hungry and thirsty. We are in rags. We are brutally treated. We are homeless. We work hard with our hands. When we are cursed, we bless. When we are persecuted, we endure it. When we are slandered, we answer kindly. Up to this moment, we have become the scum of the earth, the refuse of the world. Now, this might sound, if you don't understand the context, like Paul's having a pity party, but it's not. Paul is pointing out that the riches and honor and peace that some are choosing to enjoy in society comes not from being blessed by God, but from being no threat whatsoever to the evil layered into the systems of society around us. So their proof of God's favor, how easy everything is actually proof of Satan's indifference. You're not a threat to me. Go on, collect your belongings. You go ahead, keep your wealth, keep your peace. James, the brother of Jesus, echoes the futility of the I get along well in society thinking in James chapter 2, verse 5. Listen, my dear brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised those who love him? Now, look, we're not looking to be antagonistic with society or politicians or policymakers. Romans 13 instructs us to honor our government leaders. Romans 12:18 directs us that as far as it depends on us, live at peace with people. We're not talking about picking fights with those around us, but it is our faith that makes us aware of fights that are happening around us, fights that are already happening, and it helps us to see when battle lines are drawn. We don't pick the fight, but we do know to stay on God's side. That's the first step to picking a side. You have to be able to see that the conflict is happening and where the battle lines are drawn. And make no mistake, God is never on the same side as sin. Ever, ever, ever. God's character is unchangeable. He will never be on the same side as sin. And that means often society. A society filled with broken, sinful people is not on the same side as God, particularly if they want to celebrate sin rather than repent of it. So it would be a mistake to think that joining them is how we help them. That's not what Daniel did here, was it? No, he was willing to suffer to continue to quietly, humbly continue his walk with God. He didn't do anything flashy or defiant or political. He just kept living out his reality that God is real. And being right with him is more important than anything else to Daniel. That's so clear. His enemies knew it. They completely knew it. And by doing so, Daniel was able to offer people real help because he was able to offer them a glimpse of the living God. Daniel seems almost passive compared to the dynamic calculations and political pressure and leveraging that his enemies displayed. Oh, the hoops they jumped through to shift all of society over just to make Daniel stand out in his obedience. But look at the power of Daniel's simple, humble obedience unleashed on the Persian Empire. So it boils down to one question. Is God your everything always, or your sometimes maybe? Daniel made his choice. You and I need to do the same thing. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for this accurate historical account of when society shifts away from a lifestyle that your people can faithfully continue. Because, Father, we find ourselves in these circumstances again and again in history. And we look to your word and we see what actually works, what is actually your will. And Daniel's example is so good. So, Father, we ask, first of all, help us to see the battle lines. Help us to continue to follow you. And we ask, Father, that you would Help us to carefully, cautiously do this in a humble way rather than a defiant or political way. Show us how to follow you on your terms. Father, we pray for the society around us. We do ask that eyes would be opened. We also recognize, Father, that you will not override anybody's thinking. And so we understand with sadness, Father, and we grieve with you at the many people who will continue on their road to damnation confidently, purposefully, and our heart breaks for them. That too is a part of our witness. We pray, Father, you give us courage to follow you humbly and to grieve with you about those who choose to stay lost. We pray this in your beautiful name, and we thank you that you have saved us. Amen.
If you say go, we will go. If you say wait, we will wait.
If you say step out on the water, I may say it can't be done.
We will fix our eyes on you and we will come.
If you say go, we will go.
Than our ways, and the plans that you have laid are good and true. If you call us to the fire, you will not withdraw your hand. We will gaze into the flames and look for you. If you say go,
receive this benediction from 1 Corinthians 15:58. Therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Go in peace.
No, not by might, nor even power, but by your Spirit, O Lord. Healer of hearts, binder of wounds, lives that are lost, restored. Flow through this land.
So we want to thank Ebenezer for allowing us to participate with them in their worship service. And for next Sunday, we will be worshiping together with Langley Mennonite Fellowship.